Morning, morning, morning. It's Saturday, the 4th of March, 2017. Welcome along to this morning's United Kingdom Talk, boys and girls. The station, the programme that stops you from shopping. Oh, yes. When I put up the little message on Facebook, Wendy was just about to go out shopping, weren't you? Wendy up in Leyland. Drive a British car with British Leyland super deal. Except they're not there anymore, are they? Just Wendy. Everyone, all the car people in Leyland left, boys and girls, and they left Wendy living there all on her own. Wendy is the only person that lives in Leyland now. And she's not making the cars. You know, I thought they'd just left one of their members of staff behind. There she'd be screwing those little old nuts on, darling, attaching an alternator here, there and everywhere to the cars. But no, she's been left on her own. But what a nice day it is out there. The sun is beaming, boys and girls. It is shining down on you, the righteous, in the name of the Father, the Son and the Holy Ghost. It really is. It's okay, it's not a religious programme. Not yet. That could all change. Who knows? We could be taken over by religious extremists here. Now, look at this. Look at this in the Super Soraway BBC website, and we must get down on one knee whenever we mention the word BBC. ITV, not bothered. BBC, we must always get down on one or two knees, possibly, in some circumstances, depending on which office you're in. We get down on one or two knees when we hear the name BBC. Because in the BBC website this morning, the BBC is investigating. And now you wonder why I lock my doors before I come up on here. Hang on, we're on that camera now, aren't we? We haven't changed camera. I'll tell you about that in a minute. The BBC is investigating after several people gained unauthorised access. Has that ever happened to you? Has anyone ever gained unauthorised access to you, I wondered on? The BBC is investigating after several people gained unauthorised access to one of its studios during a live broadcast at Broadcasting House. A group of five entered the studio at the building in central London at around 19:30 hours, that's 7:30 p.m. for those of you that are not into metrics, on Friday. The BBC News Channel was using the studio at the time, but the intruders were not seen on air. They take away all the fun, don't they? We want to see those intruders. Intruders. You may remember years and years ago. Oh, I'm going back a long time now. Sue Lawley, who was a great... I don't know what's happened to her. Maybe she retired. I don't know. But Sue Lawley used to read the news on BBC One in colour. In colour. And I'll never forget, it was the 6 o'clock news and the music... How did the music go? Was it the... No, that was a 9 o'clock... No, that was a 9 o'clock. I can't remember now. Doesn't matter how the music was. Music, I think, in television at the beginning and at the end is very, very important. Sometimes I only say for the introductions. Things like Bruce Forsyth's Generation Game. Life is the name of the game. What about... Every Second Counts. And here's your host, Paul Daniels. Obviously not now, because he's gone. But there we are. And Bob's Full House. You remember that one? Do you remember that one? I don't. Oh, Bob's Full House. And here's the master of the house, Bob Monkhouse. I love it. The Golden Shop. This is your golden day. Everything's going your way. TV themes are very important. Neighbours. Everybody needs good neighbours. What is your favourite TV theme? I shall be asking you that very shortly. TV themes. I want you to ring in and tell me what your favourite TV themes when the phones are open. Don't all rush. Not yet. Lines are not open yet. We can't afford to have them open for the whole hour. It's far too expensive, dear. just for a few little moments. So stand by your telephones. So Sue Lawley, I've actually remembered where I was in that story. That's unusual, isn't it? Usually I go off on a tangent. I can't remember where I was a few minutes ago, but I have remembered today. My brain seems to be functioning within its normal perimeters today. So Sue Lawley was reading the 6 o'clock news once, and suddenly they were invading by, I believe, the group was called Lesbian Avengers. I believe that's right, and they invaded the studio, and it was very exciting. This was while she was reading the news, and she said, oh, we do appear to have been invaded slightly. And these women were coming in, and security guards were dragging them. They were dragging them outside of the studio. I wonder what happened to them. Do you think they were dragged outside and beaten? You've got to beat these people down. Beat them down. Beat them down. Oh, my word. So last night, oh, let's say hello to the early people this morning. One moment, please. Good morning, early people, too. Who's got the first message? Oh, Wendy's got the first message. Good morning, Wendy. Adam's with us. Adam the plumber, who turned up last night at the karaoke and sung two songs. But my favourite was Chitty Chitty Bang Bang. Oh, pretty you, chitty, 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 bang, bang, chitty, chitty, bang, bang, we love you. And chitty far, chitty in a motor car, oh, what a happy time we're... And all that business. Very fast song. I don't know how you managed to keep that up with your teeth like that, Adam. There are occasions I did see his teeth slightly fall down, and I thought any moment now they're going to shoot out and end up in someone's drink, dear. You have got to be so careful with false teeth. Can't you get that glue stuff that they keep advertising on the telly, Adam? It's very, very concerning to have teeth flying out across the floor. I mean, they're not cheap, are they? God, I was talking to a bloke in the gym changing room the other day, and he was saying he's having a tooth done, and it's like £1,500 for one tooth. I just had the thing ripped out, dear. You got loads of us. Why do you need that particular tooth? God's sake, man. Good morning to Tony Power, Eurovision writer extraordinaire. Morning, Tony. Zach's with us this morning. Good morning, young Zach. All right. A lovely Shania on Isley Widget. Isley Widget. ISLEOFWIGHT. Isley of Widget. Good morning, Shania. Pete Branch is with us again in sunny Brazil, but it's better than it is here. It's actually sunny out there. It's quite warm this morning. I was able to go out to my bin and empty the cat dirt in the bin in a T-shirt. Sometimes I go out there in just a small pair of white pants. And I do see that the neighbours are looking. Oh, good morning, neighbours. And I just carry on with my business, too. Putting the used newspaper and cat poo directly into my bin. I often wonder sometimes, because you know you're supposed to separate paper and all this business, right? So the cat poo is in newspaper. Well, you're not supposed to put newspaper in the household rubbish, are you? I mean, are you supposed to somehow, perhaps with a fork or a knife, scrape off the cat poo into that one and then put the paper in the other one? Is that how it works, lovey? I must ring up Bracknell Council about this. I don't want to break any rules. I really don't. We don't like rule breaking. No, we don't. Good morning to Jason Carter. Good morning, Jason. You're looking very smart, I must say, in that lovely little bow tie and all that. I don't wear clothes like that, unfortunately. I'm not invited anywhere, Jason, to warrant purchasing a dinner jacket and a black tie. I don't get invited to posh places at all for some strange, unbeknown reason, you know. I mean, I shop at John Lewis. I've got John Lewis bedding. Bedding. Can't understand why people don't invite me to these posh parties, Jason. Good morning to John Child, who did not turn. You weren't there last night, John. You missed Maureen's birthday. She's very angry with you. Yes, Maureen is very angry with you for not turning up at her birthday yesterday, John C. Very, very disappointing indeed. As I say, it was a great night last night. Maureen's birthday. We had a lovely birthday cake made by Ice. I only told Ice, actually. I think it was Wednesday, late night Wednesday, or even maybe Thursday morning, because I couldn't find her phone number anywhere. So Ice generally makes the birthday cakes that we have given to people at Central Station for their birthdays. And you've got to be a regular. You've got to be a regular to get a birthday cake. There's no point coming once and then, like, 6 months later, you come again. Or 4 weeks later, you come. That's not regular. Oh, no, 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 no. If you want the birthday cake, you're going to come every week. You're going to come twice a week, every week. I mean, Ray Reynolds only comes once a week now. Don't know what's going to happen on your birthday. Mind you, it is about a year ago, year away, your birthday, Ray, isn't it? So you do have time to redeem yourself. Hell, Redeemer, King Divine. You have time to redeem yourself, Mr. Ray Reynolds. You've got to come every week, twice a week, for a minimum of 6 months before you get on the birthday cake list. Who's got the birthday cake list? Hello? And anyone spotted going to other karaoke nights, and I will know, you know, on the same nights as I have mine, will be struck off the list. You will be excommunicated from Central Station. Excommunicated. That's what's going to happen. This. So that was Maureen's birthday last night. As I say, Ice made the cake, which was, as always, very gorgeous. Of course, I couldn't have any because I've given up cakes for Lent. Cakes, crisps, chocolate, sweets. That's what I've given up for Lent. So I couldn't have any cake. The only bread as well. The only bread I am allowing myself to eat is Maureen's sandwiches that she brings me in every Monday and Friday. Without fail, she brings me in a little box with some salad and cheese sandwiches in and a couple of bananas, which are particularly delicious. And I'm carrying on with those. For the only reason is that Maureen takes such pleasure bringing them to me. So that would be unfair to remove that pleasure from Maureen. So there we are. I do have little sandwiches twice a week. And that's all I have. Ian turned up as well. Ian is Ice's other half, who whenever I talk to him, he just tells me to F off. I'm not quite sure that was. I think he's being funny. I'm not sure whether it's been funny or not. There were some old Black Cap customers in there as well last night. When I say old, they're not that old. They're certainly younger than me. But they used to come to the Black Cap, which is a place in Camden Town that I worked at for quite some years. 18 years I was there, actually. And it's closed now. It closed a couple of years ago and the building is empty. And there is actually a campaign trying to get it open. And there's some wonderful people who hold a vigil there. Every Saturday afternoon, they go out, they stand outside, they've got reopen the Black Cap, and they hand out leaflets, and they're all very colourful. And it's a great thing to have the time and be able to do that. I'd be there, if I had time and I was in London, I'd be there with them. A very, very important pub, the Black Cap. And some of the old customers were there last night, and right at the end of the night, and I'm getting better at this Wendy, because Wendy knows, most of you know, I have a problem with thanks. So, you know, you do something and, oh, thanks ever so much, Chris. That was a great night or something like that. Or they come up and, you know, there's only one manager that does it. Duncan, funnily enough, at Central Station. Now and again, at the end of the night, he'll say, can I have the microphone? I thought, oh, no, he's going to thank me. And I can't stand it. I can't stand it. And Wendy had picked this up and she says, you've got to learn to take the thanks. I think I'm getting a little bit better at that now, Wendy. I am. Anyway, these four chaps from Black Cap came up last night after I finished, was packing away, and they wanted to thank us for such a wonderful night and how nice it was to come and see what I do. Although I'm not DJing, I'm doing karaoke, but it's still me doing it. Do you see what I mean? You kind of have your own way of doing things. I like things to be done properly. Duncan, who's the manager at Central Station, will tell you, although you'll never see it while I'm standing on the stage, I get really upset when things are not running smoothly. And it's always down to someone else. Not me. It'd be down to someone else or something else. Like if I was to come late, I've never actually been late. So if I start at 8 o'clock, I've never got there after 8, but I might have got there at 8:02. And I want to be there at 7:20, set everything up, try it all out so I've got space to play with in case something's not working wrong, in case something's gone wrong. And things do go wrong. And I get really upset when things don't run smoothly. There's a certain group of people that sit on the stage. Now, funnily enough, they haven't been there for a few weeks. Hooray! Right? But they do not move quickly. You know, we're going to do the karaoke. OK, well, we'll just finish our drinks and we'll move. No, go now. We're trying to set up. And it's not for me. This is the thing that I find. some people find so hard in understanding. It's not for me that I want you to move. I want you to move so we can set up. So at 8:30 or 8 o'clock, depending what night it is, so when the karaoke is advertised to start, it starts. Very happy to start early. If I'm ready early, that's okay. No problem at all with that. But I don't, if you know, if it says 8 o'clock, it, to me, that's 8 o'clock. The people expect it to start at 8, not 5 past, or 1 minute past, or 8:15. 8 o'clock is 8 o'clock. I'm very much like Theresa May. Brexit means Brexit. Well, 8 o'clock means 8 o'clock, dear. So we want to start. Get off the bloody stage. And oh, we'll just finish these. We won't be very long. No, go. So it's for them, you see. It doesn't bother me. I get the same money. But it was never about the money. And I was saying this again then to last night. The bloke says to me, I bet you don't charge enough for this. I said, well, I charge. I'm happy with what I get. That's it. Happy with what I get. Don't need to be filthy, stinking rich. Already am. Thank you. Chris Andrew says, I was the first karaoke at the Black Cap. Yes, you were, Chris. Chris used to work with me at the Black Cap. I was DJing there, and Chris used to come and do the karaoke there. And he was the first karaoke man that I worked with. He's watching with us this morning. Good morning, sir. Morning. Good morning to Gustav. You weren't there last night, Gustav. You missed Maureen's birthday. Oh, it was wonderful. Little Maureen's birthday. Daniel's with us this morning. Daniel and Camberley. Good morning, Daniel. Rod Brown's there today. Good morning, Rod. Thank you, by the way, Rod. You always share my stuff, don't you? Certain people on here keep sharing what I'm doing, and I do appreciate that. I never ask people to do it. You often I get fed up with those. Oh, please like and share, and then it's, you know, some, I don't know. Sometimes the stories are very sad. No doubt some of them true. No doubt some of them not true. Which ones are true? Which ones aren't? I don't know. You know. Please share and repost this if you find my lost cat or something like that. Oh, but I never ever put that. Please share and repost. Or very, very rarely do I put please share and repost. I think that should be up to the individual. It's like these people, you know, when you get these awards things that are going on in a local paper or something like that. And they say, oh, please vote for me. Oh, and they go on and on. Vote for me, vote for me. Well, it makes you not want to vote, doesn't it? It's as simple as that. Pete says it's cold today, 8:30 a.m. and only 25 degrees centigrade. Pete, what's that, dear? 25 degrees centigrade. What's that? That's foreign. That's foreign, that. I don't know what that is, dear. Oh, do you mean about 80 degrees Fahrenheit? Is that what you mean, lovey? We don't do centigrade here. Not since Brexit, dear. It's back to Fahrenheit. Inches, miles. Ounces. Kilograms. No, what are they? Kilograms. What do you weigh? Oh, 84 kilos. What's that? I don't know what that is. 84 kilos. What is that? What is that? It's about 13 stone. Ah, now you're talking, dear. Imperial measurements only on the United Kingdom talk, Chris. All right, Pete. Tony says TV themes. Always is mentioning TV themes. Here we go, then. Here we go. So what is your favourite TV theme of all time? And would you like to sing it down the phone to me this afternoon or this morning? Just coming up to 13 minutes past 11. If you're watching the show live, you know if you're watching the show live, there is a little red thing in the corner. I think the top left-hand corner says live. It's even flashing occasionally. How exciting is that? If you're watching a recording, then that little live thing isn't there. Just mentioned about cameras a minute ago. I've now found a way, because we're on the new camera. Since I changed the background, okay? Since I changed the background, there's no more problems with the camera at all. So, what I do... Hello, Ray, I'll be with you in a second. Can I just ask you to just hold a minute, all right? Please hold. Thank you, Ray. Yes, you will know that the background kept going all funny like that. But that's cured now. The only thing is, I didn't have enough blue material. Okay, so we now, the recorded part of the show is now recorded off that same camera rather than my iPhone. It saves me a lot of time as well. I'm just going to show you something here, all right? Let me show you this. Now, you see, the thing is, what I've had to do, because I didn't have enough material, I've had to zoom in slightly. Watch what happens if I zoom out. There you go, you see? I ran out of material. See, so what I've had to do is zoom in slightly. There you go. So you can't see that. However, new material is on its way, boys and girls. It's coming. Don't worry. More has been ordered from Amazon, but I just hope that it's the same. It's the same colour, because it might be a slightly different colour, mightn't it? Good morning to Ray Reynolds, calling in from London. Morning, Ray.
Good morning, Chris.
How are you today, sir? All right?
This is once a week Ray Reynolds here.
Hello, once a week Ray Reynolds. Is that all you can manage now at your age, my darling? Oh, you missed the birthday of the year last night, dear. Oh,
yes,
Maureen's
birthday. I'll be in on Monday.
Oh, poor Maureen.
I'm deaf in the left ear.
Are you using your right ear? Might be a wise.
I can hear you in my right ear. I'm holding the phone in the right ear, but I can't hear in the left. I'm completely deaf. Yeah. And the reason I'm deaf is because I'm using drops. And if I stop the drops, I'm still deaf. And when I go to have my ear syringed on Wednesday, if they can see the eardrum, they won't syringe it because there won't be any wax there. So it's a catch-22. It's either use the drops and be deaf, or don't use the drops. Answer this question. Should I have it syringed? She won't syringe. If they see the eardrum, they won't syringe it. So I'm going in circles. I'm going mad, dear. You know that.
Is that a bit of a messy thing to have your ears syringed?
Oh, it's lovely when it's done properly because it makes swishing noises usually, if it works, as it should do, perfect.
Tell us the procedure, what happens. So you walk into the doctor, then what?
You have to use drops 3 days before to soften the wax. And then she'll have a look in the ear, he or she, and then she'll syringe it. Then you hold the bowl underneath the ear, and then the water and the thingy goes in your ear and brings out the wax and the muck.
Well, she got a hose or what?
It's water.
Is it a hose?
I don't really look much at it, really. I let her get on with it. But as I say, she may not. If she can see my eardrum on Wednesday, she may be like the nurse 3 years ago and say, well, I can see your eardrum. I can't syringe it. Because there's no wax there to syringe.
Yeah, but you don't want that because then you know there's something wrong with your ear. Don't you?
I went to the ear, nose and throat at King's Cross once because I was so desperate 3 years ago because they threw me out. You've got to have a referral to be seen, you see.
Oh, really? I didn't know that.
I don't know what's going on. We'll be in on Monday for Maureen's birthday. That's the most important. And good. Johnny's coming as well on Monday.
Lovely, lovely. And, well, you've missed the cake, I'm afraid, Ray.
I said to
Maureen, do you want to save a bit of cake? No, I can't be bothered, she says, if he's not going to turn up. That's what she said.
I've got to sing you a theme tune.
Oh, yes. We're talking about theme tunes this morning.
This one's out of the arc. Yes. Only people of a certain age will even remember it. But I think you might remember Double Your Money.
Oh, yes. Just
Huey
about.
Green.
Was that Black and White?
Black and White, 1955.
Right.
And it goes, double your money and try to get rich. Double your money without any hitch. Double your money, it's the only lucky day. Double your money and take it away.
Yeah.
Double your money and take it away. Cha, cha, cha.
Very good, Ray. And which television company produced that? Was that
Associated Rediffusion?
Oh, that was a Rediffusion. No, I don't. I kind of remember it. Kind of remember it, but I don't remember the logo at the beginning of the show, dear. Was it that little thing that goes round and round?
Associated Rediffusion was. Da, 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 da. That was that one.
All right. Why is Carl with us this morning? Carl Gambrill. You should be at work cutting people's hair, dear. Carry on. Sorry, Carrie, I just noticed a name come up there. Very unusual to see a hairdresser on a Saturday morning watching. 20 past 11 in the morning should be cutting hair, dear. Carry on, Ray.
Yeah, so Associated Rediffusion became Rediffusion.
Yes.
And I think that went da, 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 da.
That's the one. That's the one. Yes, that is correct. Yeah. I remember that.
We're coming into your lifetime.
Yes,
now.
My lifetime. My very, very short lifetime in comparison to yours.
You were born?
1963. Thank you very much. A great year for the world.
Very cold winter.
A wonderful, wonderful year for the world, darling. Yeah, but it was a cold winter until I was born. And then the warmth of my little body filled the earth with happiness and fun.
Everyone had burst pipes.
Yeah, pardon?
Burst pipes.
Don't come to me about your health problems. Burst yeah. pipes? Oh, that must be. You know, that's called an aneurysm.
Oh, it was too much.
There's a lot yeah. of those on Casualty recently, if you watch it. Da, 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 da,
yeah,
da,
no, I'm not into da. That.
Don't you
yeah.
watch that?
I remember Emergency Ward 10.
That's another black and white one, isn't it?
Yes, another black and white one. Yes, we had
I
lots
mean, when
of fun
with
black
when
and
you
white,
think
yeah.
about it, terribly racist times. Terribly racist times when everything yeah. was either black or white. Now
war,
we have colour. Everyone's
was,
together.
All the world
excellent.
Was in black and white, you know. Completely in black and white, everybody.
What? Do you remember, Ray, did anyone ever tell you if you got a white aerial lead and plugged it into the back of your telly, you would get colour pictures? Does anyone ever tell you that?
Oh, that's too bad. No, we've had this one before, but
that's
when we
true.
Were kids...
That is
when,
what people, some people thought
when,
that.
When we
and
were
I
kids,
spent,
we had black
I
and white
spent
TV.
Weeks trying to convince my dad to buy a white aerial to plug into the black of our black and white telly, and it would produce colour pictures because he wouldn't have none of it because my dad was too clever for that.
When we were children, we used to buy a Quality Street and get the wrappers and stick them on a black and white television. Lick the wrapper of the suite and put it on the screen. Look, colour TV, Mum.
Oh my God! I bet she used to go mad. All that you get all that sticky toffee on the front of your telly.
And then they used to come out with this fake. I think they used it in Coronation Street with Hilda Rugden. You could go down the market and buy a Perspex thing to stick on a black and white TV, and it was blue at the top and sort of a greeny colour in the middle, or green grass at the bottom and pink in the middle, and it would just give an effect of a hazy idea of colour.
But is that true?
And Hilda Ogden, it was used in the show Coronation Street. Stan came in, he'd given so much for this bloody thing, you know, stuck it on the screen. Oh, look, colour TV, isn't it marvellous?
How funny is that? That's and people actually
quid.
Thought that was colour,
down
did
the
they? Very, very yeah. strange. Well, have a lovely day, Ray. Thanks for calling in, my friend.
And you too. It's looking very smart. I love the new look.
Thank you, Ray. I've ordered a bit more material, so it goes a bit further
yes,
across.
Yes, I like
though.
The zoom out just now. We saw the secrets.
Oh,
the secrets.
Cameras and everything in here now. Yeah, I'm of thinking of putting a camera behind me so you can see what I'm looking at. What do you think of that suggestion?
Oh, yes, we like the side view.
Would you like a side view?
Side view.
We
yeah,
can have
I'm not
that now.
Mention the nose, as Ronnie does.
There's lots to do, dear. Lots to do. Many
always
improvements
lots to, do in
to be made.
In the Mirrorball studio.
Thank you. Ray Reynolds, thank you for calling.
News at 10. Goodbye.
Cheerio, Ray. Ray Reynolds calling in there, boys and girls from London. Oh, he's a nice man, he is. He's a very nice man. TV themes. We've got... Oh, where's that gone? Oh, dear. Now, I've lost that. Now, where were I? Someone sent in some TV themes. Oh, gosh. Oh, there's so many messages. I've missed them all now. Hang on a minute. There's someone sent in some TV themes there. Where's it gone? Oh, gosh. Here we go. Tony Power. Thank you, Tony, who sends in some suggestions of TV themes for me to sing for you. Here we go. The Virginian, do you remember that? Bum ba dum bum ba 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 ba. And that leads me on to remember one of my favourite programmes when I was a child, The Waltons. Da 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 ba 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 da 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 da. What was your favourite TV theme in all these years gone by? Let me know. You can call in now. Lines are open. 020-8144-3477. 020-8144-3477 is my phone number. It's a local London number. You will not be charged a premium rate for that. It's a local London number. 020-8144-3477. Only, of course, if you're watching the show live. Or you can Skype in. If you've got Skype, you can Skype in. My Skype in username is... All one word, United Kingdom Talk. What's your favourite TV theme? You can sing it as well down the phone to me if you want. Don't be afraid of calling in, OK? If you think, I might not be able to talk and all that, I will get it out of you. Don't worry, I shall make you feel comfortable. Comfortable, unlike sitting on a Ryanair flight. That's not comfortable, lovies. Not comfortable. Thank you. Tony also mentions the Waltons. Get Smart. Now, I don't remember that one, Get Smart. Don't remember Get Smart. No, sorry. Sharon, my sister, is with us. That's Sharon Butler. That's my sister. She's up in Lincolnshire. She says, was just sitting watching an Elvis film, Girls, 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 with great-nephew George and great-niece Emily. Was it George? Who wasn't well yesterday? Oh, no, it was Harry yesterday. Don't children get ill a lot? They've always got some sort of high temperature or some sort of liquid coming out of one of the ends, haven't they? They say I'm a loser. George and Emily says I'm losers. You're a loser, Chris. Losers! 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 Yes, good morning to Dennis Granger, who's with us. Carl Gambrill, as I say, is with us this morning. Should be cutting hair somewhere, but has taken the day off just to watch the programme. Now, that's what I called a dedicated viewer. Dedicated viewer. Mark's with us this morning, Mark Coban. It was his birthday on Thursday. You may have heard us sing. Happy birthday. He's 26 now, aren't you, Mark? Happy birthday, Mark. Terry H is with us this morning. Morning, Terry. Hope you're drinking out of that mug that I gave you. We did mugs a little while ago. We were sending out mugs. Have I got one here? I haven't got one here, I don't think. There's one in the bedroom. I haven't got any left anymore. Oh, there might be a couple coming. There might be a couple of slight second mugs coming. Okay, I'll let you know at some point whether they are available. Whether they are available. For nothing. Sean says he likes the new backdrop as well. Thank you, Sean. I wasn't too sure of it at all when I first put it up, I'll be honest. In fact, I hated it. I did hate it. However, after the first show, a couple of people said they liked it. So I'm quite pleased about that. Thank you very much. Adam likes the idea of a camera behind me. Thank you, Adam. Burst pipes is one for Adam. If you have any burst pipes, don't forget Adam the plumber, who's with us here, is Adam Tubero, T-U-B-E-R-O. He covers the whole of London and the South East. He'd probably go up north a little bit as well. And he will not rip you off. Here's my promise to you. He will not rip you off if you ever need any plumbing work done. There's none. And you'd be surprised at how much he charges. You'd be very surprised. None of this caller. Hello? Hello, is that the plumber? Yeah. How much is it? Hello? Well, that was strange. I think someone might have been calling in at that point. It just suddenly went, ooh, it went, ooh, and then stopped. Hello, is that the plumber? Yes. Yeah, £250 call-out charge and 57 pence for the washer. Now, there's none of that with Adam. No, there's none of that with Adam. You would get charged the 57 pence for the washer and perhaps a little bit more on top, you know, for his travelling and all that business. So there's your man. Rod says, start again. My favourite TV theme is I Like Muffin the Mule. Now, Rod, I hate to say I know that one. We love Muffin, Muffin the Mule. We love Muffin, Muffin the Mule. Now, this was an old donkey. Not a real donkey. A little puppet-type donkey thing. That was a child's programme years ago. Gustav says, happy birthday, Maureen. Was she doing the vodka shots again? Well, she could hardly stand up by the time she'd left that place, our Maureen. You know, she likes a good old drink. Oh, Chris, thanks very much. Of course she wasn't doing vodka shots. Maureen never gets drunk. Never. Unlike you, Gustav. Dear me. I was disappointed you weren't there last night. There was no one squeezing my bum as I walked around. I didn't get one squeeze last night, no. I couldn't be there as I had an operation yesterday. A little nip and tuck in the nether regions. But again Friday, see you there. Are you having a bum lift, Gustav? That's an idea. Talking of facelifts and things like that, there's a lad who comes in called Jamie. Jamie, he likes to be known as Jamie Lisa Left Eye. I'm not quite sure why he likes that title, but he does. Jamie Lisa Left Eye. He comes in on Mondays and Fridays. And he was saying, he was talking to me outside last night, and he calls me Dad for some reason. He calls me Daddy. He said, Daddy, he's the one that put on my Facebook wall weeks ago now, Chris Reardon is the pimp MC daddy of all daddies. Something like that. I quite like that. The MC daddy. I quite like that. And he was saying last night, well, I'm going to be 29 soon. It's all over at that point. What is it with young people? And I think I was the same, actually. Well, the young people, they think that, you know, once they go over 20, that's it. It's all over. It couldn't be further from the truth, Jamie. My favourite period of age was between 32 and 47. I think that's where I had the most fun. I was going out all the time, meeting loads of people and all that business. I think that was the best time, Jamie. I really do. You know, I mean, you know, when you came up last night, I've got to say, Jamie, when you said it's all over when you get to 29. Well, it doesn't have to be. I mean, you can have your face done, darling. You can have a little something done to your face. I mean, could do with a little bit, I suppose. You know, I'm not one to criticise what people look like. You know, and when you turned around and walked off, I thought, maybe you could do something about that bum as well, lovey. You know, the surgeons can do some wonderful work now. All you've got to do is work a little bit harder on that little job you do, save up a bit of cash, and off you go. You'd have a little bit of that fat sucked out. You could have it sucked out of your bum and plumped back into your little skinny face. That'd be quite a nice idea, wouldn't it? Doesn't cost an awful lot of money. You know, stop the drinking for a while. That's a good idea. But Jamie, no, it's not all over at 29. It certainly is not all over at 29, okay? Where are we going now? Sometimes the messages don't kind of scroll up and I have difficulty finding them again. No, they're not scrolling up now, are they? I wonder why that happens. I must be doing something wrong there. Oh, no. No, that was it. Adam was the last message, wasn't it? Everyone's gone now. Bye. Go then. Go if you don't love me. That's it. Bye. Thank you very much. The throat's much better this morning. I'm not sure whether it's the antibiotics or now I've started gargling. Gargling with that Cordisil stuff. So it's one or the other. But the throat is certainly feeling a little bit better this morning. It's been the whole week. It's been a little bit like that. Let's have a look. I've bought a book. Now, there's been so many times I've bought books. I've kind of read a few pages. And then I see the rest. I don't see the story. I see the rest of the book. And I think, I'm not. And then I'd put it aside and don't bother anymore. Here is the latest book I bought. And this is the first book I bought now for, must be over a year. Oh, I should use this $5 note. My mate's going to New York soon. And he came up here. You might have seen him in the studio this week, Ronnie. And he saw this. And he was like a hawk. He said, can I have that to go to America? I had to hold him back. He was trying to steal this $5 bill. Oh, hang on. Itchy nose now. He's trying to steal this $5 bill from me. And I said, no, you're not having that. Oh, but I'm going to New York. No, leave it alone. I said, you can buy it off me. £10. £10, I said, you can buy that off me. Just a moment. Oh, excuse me. No, so he's not over now. I'm going to use it as a bookmark. Here is the book I've bought, Radio Boy. So I was in W.H. Smith's yesterday. That's a messy old shop, isn't it? Honestly, there's just stuff everywhere. Not very well laid out. Anyway, I was in W.H. Smith's yesterday. I was purchasing Maureen her birthday card. And I came across all the books. And I thought, I'll buy her a book. I didn't get her a book in the end. I got her a big, like from Marks and Spencer's, a big round bath, you know, stuff that you put in the bath. I don't know if it's a bubble bath or something better than that. I can't remember. While I was in Smith's, I was looking at the book and this attracted my eye. Radio Boy. And I've read a chapter already. I think it's probably a children's book. Have a look at the way the words are printed. You know, it's quite large. So I have a feeling it's a children's book, but don't bother me. Let me read you the summary of the programme. A brilliant and laugh-out-loud story of an ordinary boy with an extraordinary secret radio show broadcast from his shed. I mean, it's a bit very similar, really. Very similar, really, to what I do, to be honest. When Spike gets fired from hospital radio, he decides to launch his own radio show from a makeshift studio in Dad's shed under the secret identity of Radio Boy. Spike quickly becomes an underground hit, but will he handle his newfound fame well? Well, I mean, I do. You know, I can barely walk out of this house now. But, oh my God, it's Chris Reardon. That's Chris Reardon from the television. That's what it's terrible trying to get out sometimes. But you know, you try and let people like to touch you. And I'm quite happy being touched up now and again. Touched now and again, sorry. Touched now. Is calling a homework strike a good idea? Will he impress Catherine Hamilton, the girl he wants to marry? Can he keep his identity? And it goes on. And this book is actually written by someone called... I can't read the blooming writing here, dear. Oh, my eyes are failing. Ray Reynolds is going deaf. I'm going blind. There's no way out for us, is there? It was Christian O'Connell presents Britain's biggest commercial radio show on Absolute Radio. Is that the biggest radio show? I thought that was Radio 2. Was the biggest breakfast show, isn't it? Now, who is it now? Does that? Is that Chris Evans? Isn't that the biggest breakfast show? So why have they put that on there? Anyway, he presents Britain's biggest commercial radio on Absolute Radio. This is his first novel, and it's really funny. I came in last night, and generally when I get in from work, I'm not too late. Generally, the only day I'm quite late from work is a Friday. I get in very late Friday. And so last night, I put the telly on for a while and I thought, oh, I can't be bothered to watch it. But watched a little bit more of Roots, which I've now finished. The TV series that was on channel on BBC 4 Colour, Roots. If you didn't see it, it's really good. Lovely ending, because all the black people become free. Some of it's horrible. It's really awful. It's about black slavery in America and how they sold some of the black slaves to the British. Oh, it's really horrendous. It's probably available still on the BBC iPlayer. There's a couple of scenes in there that I found really disturbing. There was whipping Kunta Kinte with this whip. But in the... So you've got the, you know, the bit you hold, I don't know what it's called, and the bits of string or the whip. But in that bit of string, they put nails and it just ripped his back to pieces. It was awful. Just awful. But it's a good thing to watch because you learn. You learn about that, how terrible people were to other people. Because all people are equal. All people are equal, boys and girls. Oh, remember that. All people are equal, except those that don't shop in John Lewis. Please, if you don't shop in John Lewis, don't watch this programme, lovers. All right? I highly recommend this. Christian O'Connell, as I say, I think it's a children's book. And if this is his first book, my God, I'm hooked. Let me see if I can find a funny bit here. He was sacked, because I've read the first chapter where he gets sacked from his hospital radio show. Yeah, where's the funny bit? He hosted a programme called The Wacky Kids Wonder Hour, Saturday morning at 6 o'clock. Maybe the name of his show hasn't helped. For the record, it came from Bazza, who's the station manager who sacked him, not me. Sure, it was only hospital radio, and most people don't even know hospitals have their own radio stations. But they do, run for the most time by over-enthusiastic volunteers with bad breath and sandals. This is so true. This is so true. The thing was, I'd read in all the interviews with my favourite DJs that they started off in hospital radio. This is an 11-year-old boy talking here, OK? I collected these interviews in a special folder under my bed, safe from my sister's prying eyes, codenamed My Favourite Stamps. I'd learnt my lesson after she found a notebook I'd been practising my autograph in. I thought I followed in these DJs' footsteps. Not anymore. Me getting fired was also going to be bad news for fellow members of our AV club at school, the Audiovisual Club. There are only three members, me, my best mates Artie and Holly, and each week Mr. Taggart, one of the teachers, does his best to school us in the magical worlds of broadcasting, video and print. There had been a fourth member, Dave Simpson, but he quit for jazz club. We could hear them practicing, and I'm no expert, but it sounded like they were all playing from different pages in different books. And I was reading this last night. After, even though I was tired, after I came back from work, I was laughing out loud. I may have found an actual book that I'm going to read the whole of. Fancy that. And it's fantastic. This is really good and funny. Highly recommended. How much was it? £7. You'll probably get it on Amazon, probably even cheaper. Radio Boy is the name of this book. Please, written by Christian O'Connell, go and buy it. It's hilarious. Absolutely hilarious, all right? So that's that book there. 0208144 77, my phone number. Your favourite TV themes, I'd like to know this morning. Or, of course, you can, as sometimes you do, send it in a little message that's that will appear on my screen there. Adam says, there's so many people watching you, they are finding it hard to message in case they miss a word of your dulcet tones and why you are that's why you are short of messages. Oh, we don't worry about the messages, Adam. No, because, you know, I listen to certain people on the radio. Clive Ball, Steve Allen is my hero, Steve Allen on LBC. Clive Ball, Nick Abbott. I like Nick Abbott very much. He's on tonight, actually, LBC. 10 o'clock tonight, Nick Abbott's on. He's hilarious. I like to listen to all those. And, you know, sometimes I think I like to phone in, but I like listening to the host. I like the host so much that I don't want to ring in. And I think that's the same in this case, lovey. I think that is the same in this case. People are so excited to see and hear what I've got to say that they don't want to ring in. But if you want to, you can do 0208144 77. Adam, incidentally, who's with us this morning, has lost a lot of weight recently. If you're new to the show, he's done over a stone and a half in 7 weeks, and he keeps winning these little prizes. I'm sorry I keep looking over there. I've got to get used to looking here now. The cameras are very close together, but, you know, if I'm looking either that way or that way or that way or that way, it makes a difference. And I've got to look that way now because we're using a different camera. I'm still recording it on the phone in case something goes wrong, you see. And once I'm get used to this new system, I'll be happy. all right, 0208144 77. Something else to show you today. Now, you know, I was talking to... you about the cakes that the lovely Ice makes us. Now, if you can't get hold of Ice, okay, or you're, you know, out of the sort of London area, Marks and Spencer's are doing birthday cakes. Look at some of these. And then I don't think they're overpriced. Hot air balloon, look, £45. That's a nice thing for a child, isn't it? Look, £45 for that. Personalised cakes with your name on and everything. How marvellous. I had a couple of lovely cakes brought to me by the lovely Wendy for the United Kingdom Talk last two birthdays. Beautiful cakes. I haven't got pictures of them now, but they were beautiful. We got bears. Are they bears? Hang on a minute. Or are they rabbits? No, they're bears. Now, look, they do bears. How much are those ones? 30 portions, it says. More like four, love. 45 pounds of the bears. There's the bears, Marks and Spencer bears. And there's all sorts, there's little pigs. Oh, now this, I'm going to show you this. I'm going to get this one for Ronnie's birthday, right? Because he's a bit of a princess. Look at this. Do you like, look at that one. I'm absolutely going to get that one for Ronnie's birthday. And that is 45 pounds. It's a little princess and castles and all that. Isn't that fantastic? I love it. I love it. So I shall be getting that for his birthday. And they do little cakes as well, all for people's birthdays. And here's some of the bigger ones. I suppose these are wedding ones, are they? Yeah, £249 for that. Look, that's a lot of money on a cake, isn't it? Cool, dear. Can't you just get some Victoria sponges and put them on top of each other, something like that? Might be an idea. £250, that one. Oh, that's a lot of money for a cake, isn't it? There we are. in the newspapers this morning. Now, we're going to go upmarket for a moment. The Financial Times. Oh, my God. 0208144 77, my phone number this morning. The Financial Times. Here is a bit of good news, boys and girls. The Uber people have something thrown out of court. Tens of thousands of private hire cab drivers in London could be prevented from getting a licence after Uber lost a court battle after plans to introduce English language tests for the job. Basically, what they're saying, what the Uber driver people were saying is that they didn't... Why do they need to speak English to drive a minicab? I mean... It just gets me, because this is England, that's why, you blooming idiots. How can someone get into a cab and they can't speak English? I just don't get that at all. That shouldn't even have gone to court, should it? Ridiculous. Especially, you know, maybe there's someone from another country, you know, they're coming into London. Oh, we want to go to so-and-so. You get into the cab. Oh, by the way, can you tell me where so-and-so... Okay. It's just, that's just a non-story, isn't it? Anyway, Uber went to court about this. They actually went to court. The car hailing company submitted an application for the judicial review of four new rules last in England, including stipulations that drivers must have permanent commercial insurance, which I blooming well hope so as well, and pass a written English test, claiming that they were too strict and would undermine innovation. And that is so ridiculous. You know, if you went to, I don't know, if you went to Japan, somewhere like that, and you got in a minicab in Japan, wouldn't you expect them to speak Japanese? Some of them can probably speak, you know, in their own country. Would you not expect Japanese? You know, because, you know, I mean, if you were good about planning holidays, you would learn perhaps some phrases, please, thank you, or something like that, to speak to the people in their country. Now, so people come into this country, I'm sure a lot of them, before they come, learn to speak certain words and phrases, perhaps, so that when they get in the cab, they can say please and thank you. But what if the cab driver's foreign and can't speak English? What's all that about? It's just ridiculous. The judge ruled in favour of Transport for London on the English language requirements, saying they're entitled to Transport for London are entitled to require private hire drivers to demonstrate English language compliance. I should blooming well think so too. But it doesn't end there. Uber are going to appeal against the ruling. I mean, the whole world's gone mad. It really has. I don't know what you think about that. Don't you think that like minicab drivers should be able to speak English? Surely that's one of the you know, if you were going to an interview, you know, interviewer, well, it's not done by interviewer, is it? Uber drivers, they fill it all out online. Fill it all out online. They probably someone else fills out the thing for them if they can't speak English. But surely they should be able to speak English there. Wendy says it's called communications. That's ridiculous. Yeah, you've got to be able to communicate with your minicab driver. What if something, you know, perhaps you're with, I don't know, someone ill in the back and you're taking them to hospital and they take a turn for the worse? You'd need to communicate that with the driver. I've heard people going in Uber drivers who have talked to them and they've been told to shut up and sit down. Terrible. And I've heard of people getting in there, you know, and then they say, oh, can we just go via... No, we go from here to here. That's it. That's what you booked. Dreadful. You wouldn't get that in a black cab. Black cabs all the way. I keep saying that. Never, ever take those Uber drivers. Dreadful people. Guy says, good morning. Good morning to Guy this morning. Nice to see you as well there, sir. 020-8144-3477 if you want to call in, boys and girls. Now, where's this one? David and Victoria Beckham. Now, I rarely mention David the Beckhams on here. I don't understand why they're continuing in the paper. Now, however, on this case, it seems that £2 million in renovations on the Beckhams family new barn conversion in the Cotswolds have got underway. Security have been seen patrolling the country lanes around the property. I mean, isn't it awful to have to live... Well, of course, I mean, I have to have a lot of security walking around my house all the time now. You know, people trying to steal little bits, you know. So, and they sell it on eBay. They might... Like, I tried to get out the door the other day and someone had stolen a door handle. You know, to sell on eBay. Chris Reardon's handle. Starting bid £500. Because yeah, a lot of the stuff that, you know, because it's got my name on it, it's worth a lot of money. I shouldn't really tell you that. Next time I go out in the car, you know, probably someone will grab me and try and steal a shoe or something like that. One of Chris Reardon's shoes, you know, now available. Starting price, £750. I wonder how much that would go for on eBay. Perhaps I should try it. Security have been seen patrolling the country lanes around the Beckhams property as construction begins. But it's a barn. You know, it's like a barn conversion and it all looks very nice. Now, I'm sorry, you know, Victoria Beckham in this place. Is it me? Or I always thought barns were for old cows. Didn't you, lovey? And yet, Victoria Beckham, you're moving in one. which was a little bit strange, really. I always thought barns were for old cows, and yet Victoria Beckham is about to move in one. Very, very odd. On with some more stories, boys and girls. If you've got one of those contactless cards, be careful. Banks are racing to fix a security flaw. Banks are urgently trying to close a dangerous security loophole, boys and girls, in millions of contactless debit and credit cards. Now, I've never liked those. I don't like the way you just waft it across this machine and whoosh, £800 is sucked, boys and girls. It was sucked hard out of your account. I don't like the idea of that. Mine's not set up. Because what you have to do is touch it. And the first time you put your number in, don't you? You do that. That's how you start it off, you see. I never started mine off. I do not like contactless cards. Virtually all tap and pay cards, which can make purchases of under £30 without the need for a PIN, can be used by thieves after they are reported stolen. In some cases, criminals have been able to use cards for up to 8 months after they were cancelled. I mean, wouldn't you think they thought of this sort of thing when they were making these? What sort of people are running these places? The problem stems from the fact that contactless cards can authorise purchases offline. This means payments are automatically approved without the till. Now, I didn't know this. Without the till actually connecting to the customer's bank to check a card is valid. Did you know that? I just thought every time you used your card, it dialed a number and it goes through to the bank and checks that you are who you say you are. Apparently not. Not when you're doing the contactless. Presumably, it collects all this information and sends it off all in one go. Banks have refused to say how many times a card can be used after it's been cancelled, citing security reasons. Some indicated the cards could only be used for a low number of purchases up to the value of £50. But it says lawyers say banks' failure. So if you've lost a card, this is important to you. Lawyers say banks' failure to warn customers about the security risk means they could be breaching industry regulations. Well, surely you wouldn't be responsible for that. So, no, you can't be. Surely not. It says it's a grey area regarding who takes responsibility for money that goes missing from a customer's account after a contactless card is stolen. In theory, the bank should pick up the transactions and refund the money automatically. But it seems some expect the customers to spot them. Well, how? In some cases, banks do not even tell customers when their card has been stolen. Andy, a local councillor, said around £50 of his transactions, including McDonald's and Kentucky, went through after he reported his credit card stolen. I always thought that once you'd reported your card stolen, that's it. It's not your problem anymore, is it? You know, it goes. The moment you've told them, hello, I've lost my card, there's the number. When you put that phone down, from that point, I'm sure it's the bank's responsibility to cancel your bits and pieces so that you don't get out of pocket. When I had my stuff stolen once, years ago, and I was with, I'm going back about 30 years now, someone had written checks out. We was all checks. Check and credit check guarantee card. And this person had written checks and signed it with my signature. And I rang up the bank, National Jarrah Bank. They were very good. And then I rang them again a little while later and said, well, we've credited all the money that was spent back to your account. The signature on the checks that we received back were nothing like your signature. You know, and in one case, apparently, this person had tried to buy a train ticket with my cheque. And he actually wrote out three cheques before they accepted the signature on the third one. Well, you would think, you know, by the first one, oh, we're not accepting that, wouldn't you? But it was different then, cheques, I suppose. But the signature was nothing like mine, and yet shops let it through. I remember, though, when we had cheques, sometimes you'd write a cheque and give it to the shop, and they, oh, yeah, that looks okay. And there was no, like, they didn't, like, oh, no, I don't know about that. Yeah, that looks okay. And my signature, I don't know about yours, but it changes quite often. There we are. Ah, Guy says, good to see Ken Dodd getting his knighthood. Yes, I'm quite pleased about that. There's some people would say, oh, yeah, but, you know, why don't nurses and doctors get it? Yeah, I understand that. But it is nice when you get someone like Bruce Forsyth sort of got one, isn't he? Who's the other one who wanted one and didn't get it? Not David Beckham. He's not old enough to have one yet. I'm sorry, Davey boy. You got to do a bit more than kick a little ball around a field, lovey, and stand there in your underpants on big posters and things like that. You know, you can't just get a knighthood for that, I'm afraid. Got to do a little bit more than that. Who's the other old bloke who wanted one? Or a lot of people said he should have one. Oh, gosh, I can't remember. It might have been Ken Dodd, actually, was it? Tony Blackburn should have one. Sir Tony Blackburn. That sounds good. Tony Blackburn needs a knighthood, yes. Alrighty, let's do today's birthdays and then we're off. Oh no, let me do some messages, Bosingers. Some messages from yesterday's show. Graham. Anyway, Graham. We were talking about the subject of losing car keys. And Graham says, my brother's car is opened by its unique fingerprint on the car door handle. So he just touches the car door handle. How clever is that? Eventually, everything we do will be personalised, like voice recognition, the eye and face recognition, which is being used even in passports now. Oh, I don't know about that, Graham. Last time I went, they'd actually closed. They told us that they were closing the eye. I don't know what it's called now. I'm not sure what they call it. The iris recognition thing in passport control. They were closing that because they had so much problems with it. So I don't know if that's going to happen or not. Oh, Adam's calling in. Let's just take a call from Adam. Good morning, Adam. All right?
Good morning, Chris. How are you?
Just to let you know, I've dropped below 13 stone.
Good, 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 good. Well done, you.
So that's about a pound and a half.
Good. So obviously cutting out the crisps and the bread is doing the trick.
That's working, dear. We'll see how far we get with that one.
Yeah, a lot of people believe that weight loss is all down to exercise and stuff like that. I can actually say that I haven't done any exercise whatsoever since I started this swimming world. It's all food-based.
Well, I think you need to get yourself out a little pair of sparkly shorts and go running through that Lewisham. I'm sure that's a safe place to run with an expensive headphones on, dear.
Yeah, exactly. With my iPhone 7 sticking out my back pocket. Yep.
Well, I don't think they nick those anymore because they got so much trouble with. Do you know what? I spoke to my nephew's wife yesterday. Stacey on the phone, and she was drifting in and out. I said, "Have you got an iPhone 7?" She said, "Yeah, why?" I thought, "Okay." Same thing again.
That's it. I mean, the thing is with the iPhone, as you know, they've got so many security things on now with Find My Phone and all that sort of business. It's getting harder for the thieves to steal them. So they're just using them literally as scrap parts now if they steal them.
Oh, right. I didn't know that.
Yeah, they just get... There is the odd occasion where, you know, somebody will buy an iPhone 7 and not protect it or turn the Find My Phone off because they're doing something naughty or, you know, don't want their wife or partner to know where they are.
Yeah.
And that's the only time that you can actually, you know, fully unlock an iPhone if the Find My Phone service is turned off.
You do that a lot, do you? Turn your Find Your Phone off?
How did you guess?
What time did you leave last night? You must have left quite late.
I left shortly after you, actually.
Oh, right, okay.
Wasn't much after you. So, yeah, it was a really enjoyable night. And I think Maureen really appreciated it.
Oh, she did. She did.
Every minute of it.
Yeah, she did. She sent... She sent me a little text. She actually watches. She'll probably watch this show. I put them on a stick for her now, and then she plugs them into her computer because she's not on the internet, I don't think, at home.
Oh, that's good of you. Yeah. Downloaded shows by Chris.
Yes, downloaded shows by Chris. Have you ever... Do you fly much? You don't go on holiday, do you?
No, unfortunately, I can't afford it, Chris.
Have you been to other countries?
I've only been to a couple. I've been to Ayia Napa.
Oh, right, yes. How long ago was that?
Oh, that was back in 2001.
Were you young and pretty then, like me?
No, I've never been young and pretty. I always fell out the ugly tree.
I did the Ibiza one. I didn't go to Ayia Napa. I was watching that... I was watching Ibiza what's it called? Ibiza Weekender the other day.
Mm-hmm.
And I said to Ronnie, I said, you know, I'd love to do something like that. Do you think we'd fit in? And he just looked at me.
Well, I mean, I went to as I say, Ayanapa, and it was just somebody I was seeing at the time. And they wanted to go out clubbing every night of the week, and I just wasn't me at all. You know, I'd done my clubbing when I was 16 in heaven and places like that.
I mean, could you walk in somewhere like in, is it in Ibiza, Manumission, and say, do you do tea?
So what I did, I just took to the hills and stuff like that. I hired a Jeep and just went driving around the hills.
Lovely,
in the morning
when
everybody was staggering back to their hotel. I was up and out.
Oh, you don't hire cars in foreign countries, do you? Very dangerous, dear.
Oh, no, not at all.
No, oh, it frightened me. I couldn't drive in another country. I drove a couple of times in the States, but I didn't like it. I don't like driving in foreign countries, no.
I hired one in there, and then I went to Malta with Sean, and we hired one of those sand buggy type things.
One of those what?
You know, the, like the dune buggies with the big wheels and like the roll cage on it.
Yeah.
So like sand buggy. And we went touring around the mountains for 2 days.
Did you go and, coming round the mountains when she comes?
So we did that.
Didn't hear that, did you?
Out to see Pete, who watches the show now. I've got him involved in watching the show, Pete Branch there. He lived, at the time, he lived in Magaluf.
Oh, right, yeah.
So that was really good. And that one, again, is very sort of clubland and all the rest of it. And I actually got myself booked for 2 nights to go and do star trekking at one of the bars, because it was such a... You've obviously seen me do star trekking.
What, to sing it?
With all the different voices.
Have you done that at Central? I don't think you've done that one.
Yes, I have, yes. Done it last week.
Oh, I think you'll have to bring back a performance of that next time you're there, dear.
Yes, I will do, yes. So, been there. Been to Berlin before the wall fell.
Right.
When I was
So you have been to quite a few places then, haven't you?
Only really Europe. Right. I mean, that's it. I'll give you the list of where I've been. I've been to Paris.
Yes.
That was an on-ad-hoc trip. Got home one Friday night. The partner was with us. So I said, let's go out for the weekend. He said, okay. I said, throw a bag in the car and let's see where we ended up. We ended up in Paris.
Wow.
11 o'clock at night, not being able to speak a word of French.
Bonjour, comment ça va?
So, and it was in the days of the franc. It wasn't euro.
Oh, right, yeah.
Sorry, swore there. It wasn't in the days of those other things. So it was the franc, and we sort of rolled up to this hotel, knocked on the door at 11 o'clock at night. Room, please. And he wrote down 15 francs. No idea how much that was.
Right.
So I paid the 15 francs, and we said we want to stay the weekend. And that's all it was. And it was literally a room with a bed, with a television, open the window, and there was a brick wall. And that was literally 3 minutes from the Arc de Triomphe.
Oh, you were quite close, weren't you?
It literally was down this little backside street of Paris.
Yeah.
Just around the corner from the Arc de Triomphe. And it was 15 francs for the two of us for 2 nights.
Yeah, I've been to...
That was back in 2000.
I've been there. I've been to Paris. I just find, when I go away, I just find myself walking around aimlessly, really. Mm. I mean, it was only Israel, really, that I really went and did things that I knew I wanted to do. I got the leaflets. And once I'd done that, after I'd been to Israel, I thought I'd been doing these holidays all wrong. You know, I never used to get the leaflets. I just used to turn up and walk around places all the time.
Yeah, I know what you mean. So that was France. We've done Rome. Wouldn't really go back there again, to be honest with you. It wasn't really the country, it was more the people.
Right.
Because everywhere you went in the tourist areas, they just literally wanted to rip you off.
Yeah.
As much as they could get out of you. I'll give you an example. We stood looking at the Colosseum. I went with Sam and JJ, who you spoke to from the Isle of Widget,
Isn't he Widget?
Yeah, we were just stood there looking at the thing, and this man comes up and starts putting this band around their hand and making this band out of the colours of the Italian colours.
Yeah.
And it's like he's telling a story and all the rest of it. And it's like, oh, thank you very much. He said, €10, please. I said, sorry? €10. Oh, well, here's five. No. €10 each. It's like, no. Go away. And then his friend comes over and starts trying to take my wallet off me.
Oh, right.
At which point I pushed, he was stood on the step, so I just pushed him with both hands off the step and knocked him on the floor.
Good.
Come near us again, and it'll be more than the floor you'll be seeing.
Good, good.
So I'm not normally a violent person, but when people try to extract money out of me in front of a young child.
Yeah, you've got to have your eyes open all the time. All the time.
It's funny. Now, the Italians there, I don't know what it is for Roman. I hope nobody's offended by this. But the Italians out there seem to want money off you. But there's a lot of Indian people there that sell water and sell selfie sticks and everything and all the rest of it. And they are very fair with their prices and don't hassle you.
Right, that's interesting, isn't it? Yeah, I mean, I must admit, when I was there a few years ago, we didn't find any of that at all. And we found we found restaurants that the local people ate at, you know, just pizzas and pasta, that sort of thing. We never felt ripped off once. And the whole £50 ice cream thing, that wasn't there. We bought these massive ice creams and they were just normal price, you know.
Yeah, I know what you mean. So, it's difficult with Rome. I'm not sure I'd go back there. I'd say, went to Berlin before the war went down. And then I've been to Iron Upper, Amsterdam, and Magaluf, and that's the only places I've ever been. On my on my bucket list is New York.
Oh yes, well yeah, you need to go to New York. I think it's too busy for me, New York. Too many people there now.
It's just somewhere I've always wanted to go since.
Well, go.
You should. Never had the money.
Don't you have interest in going to Florida?
Yes, I'd love to go to Florida. That'd be another one to. Disneyland out there. I'd like to go to Disneyland. I'm a big fan of that.
Oh, you'd love it, Adam. You would absolutely love it.
Oh, I bet I would. I mean,
I think you should go to Florida before you go to New York.
Oh, right, okay.
Yeah. Virgin Holidays do it quite. Virgin are very well known for their Florida holidays.
Well, I'll see if I can get the Chris Reardon Air Miles to New York first, and then we'll start from. Thing it says the Chris Air Miles to Florida for most callers.
Well, why are you not? I don't understand why you're not earning money. You're doing all that work. Have you got a debt or something, or debts?
Well, I've got debt.
Okay.
I've got a few debts, and how can I put it? Well, you've heard some of my stories that have happened to me where I've lost money.
Yes.
I've helped people out and I've lost money.
Yeah.
And I suppose because with the plumbing service. I'm all officially registered as self-employed as well as being employed, but I just don't charge the money. I just do it to pay the bills. And once I've paid the bills, there's not much savings left. And I really should start sort of knuckling down a bit and trying to get myself out there a bit. And what with my bad back that I had, when I had my prolapse, that's thrown me out financially quite badly. I mean, I'm sort of £1,000 in arrears with bills and stuff, but with the bank and my overdraft.
Right.
So I need to build that back up before I can start saving again.
Yeah, I'm
and
with
it's
you.
Just getting back into that work set of minds,
I'm with you.
Then,
well, I shall keep advertising your services here on United Kingdom Talk.
Thank you. And it's conglomerate companies.
Thanks, Adam. Have a lovely day, sir. All right.
Thank you, Chris.
Bye now. Adam the plumber calling in, boys and girls, for all your plumbing needs. Okay, Adam the plumber. Wendy says, Adam, you work hard on your job. That's physical. So that's as good as doing exercise or anything like that, I reckon. Good afternoon to Mark Cording, who's just joined us tonight. Very late today, Mark. Very late. Anne Taplin's with us. Morning, Anne, who says New York is amazing. It is too busy for me. And it's too busy for me. No, I'm happy on the Disney stuff. Wendy says, I love Magaluf, been there a few times. Oh, Wendy, have you really? I've never been to Magaluf. Do you think I'd fit in there, on that strip where all the young people are all getting drunk and all that all the time? I don't know. Today's birthdays then, boys and girls. Let's do the birth. Oh, did we do the messages? No, we haven't finished the messages from Thursday's show. Yes, Graham was saying the eye and face recognition is now being used in passports. Wonder what will next be used as personal recognition purposes. What could they use? I don't know. Hope it doesn't get too personal. Hello to Joanna, who we were talking about what happens when you find money. I found a $50 bill outside a grocery store, which I kept. What was I to do? Ask someone if they'd lost $50. Of course, the person you asked would say, of course I did. And then they'd just take the $50. No, just keep it. But you're not supposed to. You're supposed to hand found money in, even in this country. I was surprised at that story we told you yesterday. Did you miss it? That was on Thursday, wasn't it? If you missed Thursday's show, you missed the story. You've got to keep watching them all, dear. Otherwise, it's like a missing chapter of a book. Joanna also loves the new studio. Thank you, Joanna. Love the blue. Great colour for you. And the decor is lovely. Get a bit more light so we can open up the camera again. Because that's all working now. You know, the camera's all working now. It was that background. It was really confusing, this little webcam here. She enjoyed watching the countdown. Yeah, you don't usually see, you shouldn't see the countdown on this one either. Rachel says, you look normal colour now, and when you find money on the street and keep it, it's called theft by finding. Did you know that? No, I didn't either. Thank you, Rachel. Today's birthdays, and how many we've got today? Nine birthdays today. Anthony Chisholm, happy birthday today to Anthony, sir. John Mills today is 65 years old. Happy birthday, John. Martin McKenna, it's his birthday. Lovely picture of you there with your little family, little baby in your arms there. Kasper in Australia. Now, Kasper Simonson, I used to work with at Belushi's in Hammersmith a number of years ago. Top man. Happy birthday, Kasper. I never forget all the people that I work with. Very rarely, especially the Belushi's crew. Really, I worked in these several Belushi's. The main ones were Hammersmith and London Bridge. I also did Camden and Fulham. But the main ones were Hammersmith and London Bridge. And I worked with some totally wonderful people there. Great characters and personalities that I worked with there. And I do miss those days working at Belushi's. Happy birthday, Kasper. Chris Jones, it's his birthday today. Dotty Kavina is 50 years old today. Millie Turner, happy birthday, Tony. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful man you are. An actor and he does all theatre things. Happy birthday, Millie. And Faye Wood today is sick. Well, I've got two here for you, Faye. One says you're 68 and one says you're 98. Oh, you look so much younger than both of those, darling. Happy birthday, boys and girls. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. Have a wonderful birthday, you lot, okay? Just a couple of more messages. Mark says, better late than never. Loving the new layout of the studio as well. Thank you very much, Mark. All right, I'm glad you like it. Anyway, that's it from the show today. Thank you very much, boys and girls. Tonight, it's Saturday, the 4th of March, 2017. I'll be doing some DJing and hosting cabaret tonight at Central Station in Wharfdale Road, King's Cross. The cabaret tonight is Dusty Springs. I know her very well, so it's very likely that we'll be able to stream the show for you tonight on Facebook, as we did a couple of weeks ago. It will be adult theme comedy on that one, okay? Or adult themes on that one as well, so just to let you know. No children watching, although it is on quite late at night. Of course, in different parts of the world, different times, I know. But here it'll be on around about 10:30 tonight, so I hope to bring you that tonight, okay? Cabaret with the lovely Dusty Springs, who does loads of Dusty Springfield stuff. That's tonight. Apart from that, thank you very much for watching. Enjoy your Saturday, and I'll see you again very soon. Cheerio now.